And for more on the Labor Day celebrations, let's now talk to Joshua Mata, Secretary General of Labor Group Centro. Good morning, Joshua. Thanks for joining us.
Morning, Nikki. Good morning, Mike.
So first off, it is a holiday. How's your group marking this year's Labor Day? Any activities lined up?
Yes, actually, itong araw na to is a very historic moment para sa labor movement because for the first time in so many years, lahat ng mga manggagawang unionista sa ating bansa from whatever political color they have, no, from left to right, magkakasama ngayon na magmamarcha papunta ng Menjola in order to press yung mga demands namin for sahod, trabaho, at karapatan.
Mm-hmm. And tell us about itong mga demands ba natin, the biggest challenges and problems hounding our labor system. What laws are still needed ba to protect our workers more?
There's so many laws that we still need in order to make sure that the constitutional right of workers to actually enjoy yung benefits ng fruits of labor nila ay talagang mangyayari, no? In the first place, rampant pa rin kasi ang contractualization, which is one of the single biggest stumbling block for workers to access their constitutional right to organize, collectively bargain, and to strike. Kasi alam naman natin, pagka hindi ka regular, malamang hindi ka sasama sa union, patatakot ka na sumama dahil syempre hindi na i-renew ang iyong kontrata. E kaya ito ang dahilan kung bakit marami, bagamat sinasabi ng labor code natin, pwede silang sumama na sa union kahit isang araw pa lang sila nagtatrabaho, marami talaga ay hindi sumasama. Pero apart from that, for the past 6 years, no, yung labor movement has been subjected to a very intense and systematic trade union repression. That's obviously under the previous administration, but unfortunately, the new administration has done nothing to actually alter yung lahat ng mga policies and even mga institutions that has led to massive killings, red tagging, forced disaffiliations, and many other forms of freedom of association in the past 6 years. No, in fact, we submitted a report to the ILO when the ILO finally had a chance to visit us to investigate allegations of violations of freedom of association in January. We submitted a report, a very comprehensive report prepared by all the trade unions in the Philippines, where we detailed yung 68 killings at that time. Huh? Today, 69 na yan. Mm-hmm. 68 killings that we've had since 2016, none of which actually received any justice. None. No, yung kaisa-isahan na lang sana, no, na kaso na sumampa all the way na umabot na sa prosecutorial level, yung kaso ni Manny Asuncion, ay yon din wrap pa yon ng bagong Secretary of Justice natin, no, pagpasok ng bagong administration. So, all this signals to the world, particularly to the ILO and even to our trading partners, no, na ang karapatan ng mga manggagawa sa Pilipinas ay hindi talaga nirerespeto. And that's the reason why, Nikki, the Philippines since 2017 has consistently been flagged as one of the 10 worst countries in the world for workers, no, under the ITUC Global Rights Index. And this year, nasa listahan na naman tayo ng 10 worst countries in the world. And that's really, really shameful. At the time when we're celebrating our 75th year of membership sa ILO, this is really preposterous.
Mm-hmm. Sige, before we go to how to provide solutions for these issues surrounding the labor sector, na paint us a picture of how our labor sector is doing now coming from a pandemic.
Well, unfortunately, kaya sahod, trabaho, karapatan ang panawagan namin is that even if we have finally opened up our economy, ang nangyari rather than build back better tayo, unfortunately, apparently, ay we're building back to bad normal. So what does that mean? The economy has been opened up. Yeah, bumabalik na tayo sa dati. The economy has been opened up, the economy has been growing, and yet the quality, the number of jobs, and the quality of jobs that are being generated by our economy really leaves much to be deserved, no? And unfortunately, this government is not being honest, no, to its citizenry about the economic problems that we are actually facing. On top of that, no, yung real wages ng mga manggagawa has been eroded all these years, no, it has been eroded No, to the point na marami sa mga manggagawa natin, yung real wages nila talaga ay below the poverty line na.
Mm-hmm.
Kaya there is a very strong demand from all the labor groups for wage increases. Even if magkakaiba yung mga posisyon, lahat nagkasundo na suportahan yung proposition, halimbawa ni Senate President Zubiri for a 150 peso across the board wage increase. We really think that that's a way forward. No, it's not the amount that many of us would want, but that's something that we should still support. We still support collectively. And this proposition for a wage increase na 150 across the board was echoed recently in the House of Representatives by the Deputy Speaker of the House, no, si Raymond Mendoza. Now, so one of the key points that we're pushing forward with our march today to Menjola is for government to seriously support the push for 150 peso wage increase. But that's just for wages, no? There are other problems. Now, obviously, the government needs to address yung rising prices na at yung na, lalo na ng cost of living natin, no? Can you imagine more than a decade, more than after we have actually privatized the power industry in the country, mm-hmm. napakamahal pa rin ang kuryente natin. Ito ba ang pangako ng privatization ng power is for us to enjoy a lower cost of electricity. And yet, our electricity has been consistently on top, one of the highest in Asia.
Mm-hmm.
And that's a big factor, no? Kung bakit napakataas ng cost of living natin. Apart from the fact na food is very costly sa ating bansa, mm-hmm. no? And unfortunately, the government apparently is not able to address the inflation, no? That's hitting us. Although it's a global phenomenon, obviously, but unfortunately, we have yet to see a clear plan of the government to address these things. So this is just on the economic side, no? Problema pa natin yung trabaho, no? Up to now, wala kaming nakikitang mm-hmm. industrial plan. No, so that that will ensure that government would actually be able to generate the number mm-hmm. of jobs and the quality of jobs that would lead to full employment. No, kaya mm-hmm. kami ang isang proposition namin sa employment is not just to simply try to attract investors in the country, but to actually have a public employment program, a robust public employment program, para talaga ma-map up natin yung structural unemployment sa ating bansa. And that means the government providing jobs, you know, meaningful mm-hmm. jobs mm-hmm. na magagawa natin. In fact, we're calling for guaranteed jobs. That has been working in many countries like India and South Africa, mm-hmm. for example. No, but in the meantime, just to point out about the problems with investments, mm-hmm. I just wanted to go to that point. In the meantime, while the government is heavily reliant on investors, the problem is most countries, most investors would not come to us because precisely the labor relations in the country is problematic. No, natatreaten nga tayo na mawalan pa tayo mm-hmm. ng GSP benefits natin from GSP Plus from EU at GSP benefits sa US, primarily because hindi nga natin nare-resolve yung systemic violations ng karapatan sa ating bansa.
Mm-hmm.
Sorry, Nikki.
Nabanggit nyo nga the problems housing the energy sector, pati food security, they all weave into the issues hounding the labor market. Let's talk about education naman. How has K-12 impacted our labor sector? How do you think current proposed changes to it could further affect the volume or quality of our workers? Because si former President Arroyo is saying K-10+2 pa raw. How much of an impact does the education changes to our educational system impact?
We have been following closely yung mga reports na lumalabas din eh. And truly, we have an education crisis in our needs at this point in time. And I don't think the government also have any clear plans on how to address the education crisis that we have. Now, this would obviously have an impact on us, not only in the future, but even today, no? Because as we see, sa recent report, halimbawa ng CHR, malinaw na marami sa mga graduates natin ay may problema sa pagiging employee in terms of employability nila. Now, that means that the education system that we have had these past few years is not really working the way it should be working and the way we expect it to work. So definitely we need to address this, but more importantly, mm-hmm. we need to focus much more attention in terms of public investment in our education program. yun kasi ang pinakamalaking problema. Eh. Di ba? Ang hirap pagka hindi talaga nag-i-invest ang estado natin, mm-hmm. ang gobyerno natin sa edukasyon.
Mm-hmm. And finally now, before we let you go, Joshua, where do you see our labor sector going in this administration? How can we make the Philippine labor market more attractive and more competitive?
Well, the first thing I think the first thing the government has to do is to make sure that it removes itself sa listahan ng one of the worst countries in the world, no, in terms of labor rights, no. And mm-hmm. and the best way to do that is for the government to actually adhere and listen, heed the you mentioned earlier, no, yung recommendations of the ILO high level tripartite mission. And here we are really looking for leadership, particularly from DOLE. Na unfortunately, talagang kapos na kapos sa leadership ang ating Department of Labor ngayon, no? I don't know if you know this, but DOLE was really bad when it comes to the preparing the government for the coming of the high level tripartite mission. This was supposed to come in January in 2019, and yet because the government, the previous government dragged its feet, no, tas nag lockdown, umabot na ng January this year. Ang sabi una, dapat last year, ang sabi ng bagong gobyerno nila Secretary Laguesma, bigyan niyo naman bago kami, bigyan niyo kami ng panahon. They were given time, no? January na pumunta yung ILO high level tripartite mission, which is the investigating arm of the ILO, and yet they were ill prepared. Government came into met with the mission with a contradictory position, no? Talagang hindi sila handa at wala silang malinaw na recommendation. Labor movement, on the other hand, came out with a very, very comprehensive recommendation where we are saying that we should have a presidential commission for freedom of association that will ensure that there's an all-of-government approach in respecting workers' and trade union rights. Now, unfortunately, the EO that was issued by the government yesterday came out as something that falls short of what the ILO high-level tripartite mission is expecting and what we in the labor movement is envisioning. Bakit? Kasi malinaw ang spirit ng recommendation ng ILO high-level tripartite mission. Any moves towards addressing yung mga systematic problems that labor has been raising should be done in a tripartite manner. Unfortunately, again, the Department of Labor has failed to provide us to facilitate a dialogue between the labor movement and the president himself. No, before they even came out with the EO 23, no, kaya problematic eh, kasi walang consultation na nangyari. And so, if this is the way the government will keep dealing with the labor movement, practically ignoring us and practically not having the time and providing the time and the space for us to have a dialogue, a meaningful dialogue with them, we feel that that would send a really bad signal, not just to the ILO again, but even to our trading partners who are watching us and who are looking at what government will actually do in order to address yung systematic violations ng freedom of association sa ating bansa.
All right. On that note, thank you for your insights, Joshua. You stay safe. Thank you for your time.
Thank you, Nikki. And have a good day.